Let's speak with God. Father, our hearts are before you now, and we want by the power and the miracle of your kingdom and your word to have more of our hearts vulnerable and exposed to who you are. We understand at some level that you are calling us down to unfathomable depths into your word and spirit. And that we're living in a season that's beginning, the final chapter of your church, where no longer will it be true where you can be a Christian who doesn't know you. No longer will you be a Christian who doesn't swim with you in the depths of your riches, and who doesn't dive deep into the ocean of your truth. And we know that you're going to be, by your Spirit's power, grabbing us by the arm and by the shoulders and pulling us miles under the water and teaching us that we can breathe and live there. There were rebels, Father, years ago that lived in the church that cried out. Outlaws, if you will, who experienced you. And the church didn't know what to do with them. So we either ignored them or silenced them. God, may their prayers be answered now, as they're in the great cloud of witnesses watching your holy church on earth. May what they dreamed for take place. And may the church of Jesus Christ no longer be lukewarm. Instead, may we be hot for you. In Jesus' name, take us deep today. And may we not fail to take advantage of the season we live in, which is where your word is pouring out in great number, great quantity, and great quality over anyone who asks. No longer destined just for the educated, or the pastors, or the clergy, or the rebels, or the prophet, but that all would receive, that your Spirit would be poured out on all in the church. May it be so in this room today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, we are in Hebrews chapter 10. We're going to cover one topic real quick before we get deep, and it's our first part of our notes. This is something that's been happening in chapters 8, 9, and 10. And it's the difference between a shadow versus reality. I mentioned in the last couple sessions about an airplane flying over our playground when we were kids, and how amazing that was, because this massive shadow took us over, and then that was fun. But how much more amazing would it be if the plane landed, we could get on the plane and ride? And so we're going to be talking just briefly in this chapter the difference between a shadow versus reality. And the three different types, the first one is the law is the shadow of the gospel. For instance, you know, we know that by the gospel, by the election, the purchasing of redemption, then the election of the faithful, and then the justification, and then the sanctification, and then the obedience of all that works together to create people who live in righteousness, who live in order, who live under submission to the King, to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The law was a shadow of that order. It couldn't accomplish that order, just the same way, you know, I can make hand puppets here and you can be looking at my shadow. My shadow can't make my hand move. It's my hand that makes the shadow move, you see. So the presence of my hand makes a shadow that's actually real. And so Christ is calling us to move away from trying to create and live in the borders of a shadow, instead be held in the palm of his hand. You see? See how that works? It's so much better. So that which was etched out and trying to be accomplished on earth on the basis of a shadow is the natural consequence of living under the power of the gospel. In the same way, we have the second one, and it's the tabernacle is the shadow of the true sanctuary. We mentioned that last time. Not to be mean, but the writers of Hebrews said, Okay, so there's this shadow of the Holiest of Holies. The Holiest of Holies is really the throne room of God that Christ tore the veil so we can have access to. But the shadow of it is the Holiest of Holies. And the shadow could only be entered into by one person, 0.27% of time of the year, one day out of 365. And not only could that person only enter that much, they could only enter the shadow of the sanctuary that much, that often. They could only enter in an ineffective means where they're focused on their own sin as much as they're focused on your sin. They couldn't accomplish the cleansing of your sin. And so it's almost laughable at how ineffective the Levitical system was to create righteousness in the washing away of sin. They just couldn't do it. And so, once again, Hebrews is telling us to be so much more enamored with the true sanctuary of God than to dwell in the shadow of God, which we can now through our great high priest, Jesus Christ. And finally today, we're talking about the sacrificial system. It's a long blank, but put substitutionary atonement in Christ. Substitutionary atonement in Christ. That's pretty much this whole chapter. So we'll visit this as we go. But the system on earth was a shadow, an impotent shadow of what was to come. You see, so it's all these parallels. Law was a shadow of the gospel. The tabernacle is a shadow of the true sanctuary, and the sacrificial system done by the priest was a shadow of the full sacrifice we would have in Jesus Christ. It was actually a substitutionary atonement that actually substituted for your sin. It worked. So let's read chapter 10. Here we go. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifice, repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. If it could, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. Verse 4, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Verse 3 says, but those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. The Greek word for annual reminder is actually only used four times in the New Testament. And it's the same phrase we see in Luke that says, when you do this, do so in remembrance of me, says Jesus Christ. So, whenever you break this bread, whenever you drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. Well, Hebrews is saying in a similar sense, this is on your notes, the annual reminder is in remembrance of sin. So here's a good definition that we see all through the law. It's in Romans also. The law could not produce righteousness. It was a reminder and a highlighting of the need for righteousness. Couldn't do it, but it could show you needed it. It was like almost a diagnosis. Like, great, I know I have this disease. Thanks. Thanks for the another reminder. Thank you. Oh, next, thank you again. I mean, just a constant reminder that there's something wrong. Verse 4 says, this is important to just have on your notes. Verse 4 says that the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sins. So verse 4, impossible to remove sins. I don't want to add too much to this reading because it's not explicitly mentioned, but it is implied that bulls and goats cannot effectively take away sins, mostly because it's not an appropriate substitute. They are not made in God's image. They are not guilty of the same rebellious sinning that humans are. It just doesn't work. And so what we see is that through the spilling of blood, of something that has blood that looks like us, we participated in flying on an airplane by running with a shadow. We never were lifted. We never rested in that. The only time you were in the shadow is if you kept moving with it. In the same sense, this repeated sense of spilling blood and calling it as a reminder of your sin just simulated what it would be like if blood was actually spilled substitutionally on our behalf, and it worked. It didn't work, but we kind of pretended it did. If it worked, we wouldn't have done it every year because it would have worked. You don't get a flu shot every day. If it works, it works. So there's this definite break that says in verse 4, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. The Greek word take away is the same word that's used when Peter cuts off the guy's ear. Like, he actually did it. He didn't just threaten to do it. He didn't just nick his ear. He actually cut off his ear. It was effective. Although he got in trouble for it, it actually worked. So that's the big thing that the writer's trying to say at this point, like he did with the covenant versus the law and gospel, and then the tabernacle versus the sanctuary. In the same way, he's saying, these things never really worked. Can we just, I mean, isn't that a wonderful time when you can repent and say, hey, can we come to agreement that what we were doing doesn't work? Brad Pitt on Moneyball, I love that. He said to these old scouts had been recruiting and scouting their whole careers, they were so much more seasoned than he was, but he came on as this young general manager and walked in, and these old guys were talking about this really good-looking hitter, and he's strong, and he's got a good swing, and Brad Pitt finally said, if he's such a good hitter, then why don't he hit good? You know? It's this breakthrough moment to say, wow, the Dr. Phil, how's that working for you? It's not. And so he says all this to set up the beautiful part, what's been replaced. So here's verse 5. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. Then I said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God. First he said, sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, nor were you pleased with, although the law required them to be made. Then he said, here I am. I have come to do your will. He sets aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus once for all. Let's jump up to our notes. Law-based sacrifices are replaced by obedience to God's will. Law-based sacrifices are replaced. Now, we see this all through the Old Testament. What does the Lord require of you? All the Joel and Micah and Amos. And what is God desiring actually here? And it always boils down to the same thing. The law-based sacrifices are replaced by obedience to God's will. Now, here's the kicker. Not by us, or by another sinner, but by Christ Jesus. Oh, it's easy to stop after that first sentence, isn't it? What does the Lord require of us? To be nice little boys and girls. And to work really hard. And that's such a popular teaching. It's like we're all at children's moment on the front steps. And, okay, here's the gospel. If you work really hard, God may love you. What? It's cheap. That's not the gospel. So, two things are said here. Number one is that the law has been replaced by obedience. And it was the obedience of Christ, not ours. You hear? To go back to other things we've heard in Hebrews, the people of God are called to be the people of rest, which is the essence of truth. Like, remember the shadow? There is a shadow being cast on the ground through the law. It's a two-dimensional reality when the gospel's five dimensions. It's like saying the Word of God's the Bible. The Bible is a tool to hear from the Word of God. It's like the cradle upon which Christ is laid, you see. It's a two-dimensional reality that without the Holy Spirit, without touching the actual five-dimensional, ten-dimensional truth, it's just a two-dimensional shadow. It's good because it's an actual shadow, but it's so lacking compared to getting in the plane, riding up on the truth. And so there is this thing on the law that was one of the key commandments that was written above that was actually true. That if you live into it, if you experience it, it's life, it's restfulness, it's great. And what we've preached this before, that one of the greatest commandments that we were given to be a child of God, to live into our identity, is to be able to shut off that voice that's in you that says you have to prove yourself, which is the opposite of the false gospel taught. If you work hard, you can go to heaven. That's giving into that voice. To shut off that voice through the only truth that says, I can't prove myself. Instead, I'm going to rest in a job well done, not by me, not by my friends, not by my church, but by the Lord of the Sabbath, Jesus Christ. His good work, his perfect accomplishment, allows me to enter rest. To not be restful in the gospel is to deny the power of the cross. That's why it's in the top 10. And boy, that's the one we break the most. Because we think, well, it's self-serving. I won't cheat. I won't slander. But I'm not going to rest. I'll get to that. What do they say? They're the 10 commandments, not the 10 suggestions. When you actually Sabbath in the Holy Spirit by the gospel's power because of the work of Christ, lo and behold, the law is accomplished. You're looking down, get this, you're on the plane, and because you're now part of the shadow, you look down and you see restfulness going upon the planet. Like, wow, why am I even affiliated with this? Because you got on the plane. You don't know how to fly it. You don't even know how it works. You just got on. Everywhere it flies, you see the truth falling beneath you. You see? Law-based sacrifices are replaced by obedience to God's will, not by us or by another sinner, but by Christ Jesus. Verse 10 said, and by that will we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once for all. Verse 10 on your notes says, we are regarded as holy / saints. Because of Jesus Christ's obedience. That's a hard one. Hebrews, Paul's letters, call the church the body of saints. The body of Christ is the collection of the saints. Now, the Catholic Church has tricked us into thinking that there has to be this long process until you're post-death called a saint. No. To be a saint, once again, is to say yes to God's election of your life, that he has called you by name. Jesus said, you did not choose me, I chose you to call you by name, to set you apart for a holy purpose. You're not holy in and of yourself, but what God's going to do in your life is holy. St. Paul says, who is the clay to say to the potter, why did you make me like this? He may have taken one thing to be filled with water, another thing to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He may have one object for destruction and one object for grace. This is up to the Lord. The things of God, the saints of God, have been taken and set apart to have your volume turned up for the sake of the glory of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are acting into your most eternal and natural self when you're confessing and boasting in the cross. That's why I have been pretty hardcore about asking us to keep politics turned down to a 2. And your politic, as long with mine, should be a politic of monarchy. We believe in a monarchy ruled by a royal family, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. No democracy, but the king is so good and so perfect, you never question what he does, and he loves you so much that not only are you his subject, he's your dad. The church is very political, but according to the gospel. That's why we turn it up to a 10, or as Spinal Tap says, up to 11, if anyone's my age. Okay. So that's another thing he's going to push in this chapter. We are regarded as holy, which is the other word for saints. Verse 11 says, day after day, every priest stands and performs. See the word stands? Hold on to that, because Jesus is going to be different. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest, Christ, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sin, he sat down at the right hand of God. Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. Because by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. So we've got a sentence to fill out here. Jesus sits in accomplishment. Orders famous lines from the cross. It is finished. So he sits in accomplishment. Time is on his and the saints. Remember, the apostrophe comes after the S. Plural. Time is on his and the saints' side as he waits for the full submission of his enemies. In parentheses, anyone or thing openly hostile to his reign and order. We're going to stop there and then get to the last sentence. So, my favorite verse of scripture on this is 1 Corinthians 15, which gets into the resurrection, and says that Jesus Christ is the one who's been authorized. The Father has all authority in heaven and earth has been given to the Son, and he is the one out by his presence. Everything is arranged under his order. Things angelic, things demonic, everything is coming into place as God wants it through his Son, Jesus Christ. It has been his way since the beginning, creating order out of chaos. And so Christ is executing the will of the Father perfectly to arrange all things under him. The last part of creation that's going to be subdued is death itself. Then, Scripture says, he will hand the keys of authority back to the Father, and that's when the resurrection and final judgment will occur. So the terms of surrender are still being manifested. But the war is won. Jesus sits on his throne and watches everything be brought before him. As Adam named the animals, Jesus arranges all things. Wow, God just told me. So, Jesus Christ is seated, as in he's already accomplished it, but he's not inactive. From his throne, he executes judgment on all things. And so while that's happening, the last thing that he writes in this section is, the saints are being perfected and matured. Now, we've covered the gospel several times. This would be the process of sanctification. You've already been declared holy, even though you're not. Even though you're a sinner, even though you're rebellious, me too. God has declared you to view you as righteous because Jesus Christ is all over you and upon you. In addition to that declaration, God now makes you so. He rolls through your life and removes the ruts from your life. It will happen either at the end, or you can participate with it now. The more you participate with it now, the more of your game clock's going to run. You're going to live more of your life. Or you can sit on the sideline and wait until the final judgment, the refiner's fire and the fuller's soap. That'll be fun. Or you can let him refine you now. And then a lot at the end too, I'm sure. It's this trusting that the full gospel can be effective in your life today and not wait until the final judgment. And so that's where you have two sides. You've got verse 10 and verse 14. Verse 10 says, we have been made holy. Verse 14 says, those being made holy. See the two? That's what allows for the understanding of being justified by faith and being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. The first is a complete free gift from God. You can't choose it. It's irresistible. It's God's. It's God's work in your life. The second requires your participation. Being made holy. All right. Verse 15 says, the Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. First, the Spirit says, this is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. Then he adds, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. I don't want to take the metaphor of flying in a plane too much, too far. When you're with God, it's not a matter of memorizing His law. It's about learning His voice. It's about allowing Him to put delights in your heart that are from Him, so that what you do in Him is not only heavenly, because it's a gift from Him, but it's reliant on His movement in your life at all times, and it's not a burden to you. It's joyful. In the same way, you're not the one working really diligently if you're on the airplane. You don't need to know everything. You can just be on the plane. You can know the Lord. You don't need to know and memorize and have a seminary degree. You don't have to know everything on the planet. Your life is not a bunch of memorization and regurgitation. Your life is based on knowing the shepherd. My sheep know my voice. They listen to me when I call. In the same way, again, if you're on that plane, you look down, you see a shadow being cast. Because you're counted, yourself has been absorbed into the plane, you can't see your own sin. You can't even see your own shadow. In the same way, if you've been absorbed into Christ's body, not only has He moved well past the blame game, which we could learn from, I hope, He's moved well past the blame game on where sin came from, He's also paid for it. He's covered you with righteousness so that all your sins have been imputed to Christ so He could die for it. All of Christ's righteousness has been imputed to you so you could live for God. So that when God looks at you, and even when you look at your own shadow, you see that you're part of God. You're part of the plan. The covenant we mentioned last week includes the full forgiveness of our lawless acts and our sin. And the word that came to us last week that really hit hard was, we have to get to the point where we're so enamored with who God is and what He's done through Jesus Christ that we stop being false humble. True humility is not thinking of yourself, less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less often. We're so enamored with the righteousness that Christ has put on us and that we trust that He actually paid for our sins that we quit giving them air to breathe, either by giving into our sins or by feeling overly guilty about our sins, or by letting them rule over us. We are so focused on the righteousness of Christ's purchase of our lives. So sin, the problem with sin isn't sinning, it's the focus on sin. It's the accommodation of it, it's the worship of it, it's the identifying with it. Well, I'll always be this. I guess I'm just an alcoholic. I guess I'm just, move past that and say, in my identity, the main thing you need to know is that I'm one of God's children, adopted through Jesus Christ. His righteousness has become part of my life. It's not for me. I don't even understand it sometimes, but it's there. If He declares that it's so. And to trust that part of the covenant, that Christ Jesus has actually provided perfect substitutionary atonement for you, which bulls and goats couldn't do. To live into what that's done. The more you live into what that's done, then the shadows cast on the ground beneath you in a real way. The requirements of the law are met. You see? There's too much guilt in the church. We're going to get to that. Verse 19 says, verse 18 says, and where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. Verse 19, therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter into the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is by his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God. Okay, pause there. There's a lot of therefores. But one of the first words you see is confidence. We need to mark on that because we're going to end with that at the end of this chapter. Verse 19 on your notes, the word confidence, I want you to put four words on that blank. Plainly, openly, publicly, bold. The word next to that is the actual straight translation from Greek, in quotes. It means all plus resolve. Probably, and I don't know everyone's story here, but you probably confidently buttoned your shirt today. And confidently, well, I mean, there's a lot of cars, but you probably confidently crossed the street and walked into this church without even thinking about it. This is the kind of confidence that we can have in Christ Jesus. The word confidence doesn't mean to be arrogant. It doesn't mean to be haughty. It doesn't mean to be boastful. It means, it's four words combined. It means plainly, openly, publicly, boldly. The way you walk into a bank. You do it so often you don't think you're doing it. I don't want to get in trouble here, but back in the day, before 9/11, you could pull pranks and stuff. I remember one time when you're 16, 17 years old, you're eternally bored. And I remember one time we decided to just go walk around our high school in the summer. Of course, we found an unlocked door. We're walking around. I remember I was with my friend Mitchell, and we walked around the corner. There was an adult there that yelled at us down the hall. You guys supposed to be here? And Mitchell said, are you supposed to be here? And the guy backed off, and that was confidence. I mean, just like, it was fake, but it was, we're okay to be here, and we don't feel like we have to justify ourselves. That worked fine. The guy turned the corner. We ended up on the roof, you know. Get a stage of water ballooning for the freshman disorientation, you know. All right. But it's this, you act in confidence all the time. I think that's one of the issues that if you're my friends on the left would say, I'm not on the left, but I can appreciate this. If you're an African-American, there may be a certain lack of a confidence that people might be watching you. Or if you're a woman walking across a dark parking lot at night, there may be a lack of confidence. See what I'm getting at? Am I safe? Will I be questioned? Am I justified? Do I actually belong here? Well, Jesus has established your life in such a way that you have confidence to do the things he's going to tell us right here, these next four. So I want you, the things he's going to say, I want you to just, in the same way you walk into Market Street to go grocery shopping, that's the same confidence, or even more, that you should walk into this. Do you see? Again, because we're not on the law, we're in the gospel, we're not in the tabernacle, we're in heaven, we're not in the sacrificial system, instead we've been fully substitutionarily atoned for all of our sins by Jesus Christ himself. Because of that, we can have confidence. Plainly, publicly, openly, boldly. In Greek, fully resolved to do four things. Verse 22 says, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled and cleansed from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as we see the day approaching. Okay, let's back up. There are four things. The first one on your notes, draw near to God. You can draw near to God. Hold on to that, because the opposite of being a sinner is that you shrink back from God. And pretty soon there's neither hot nor cold. You're lukewarm. You spew you out. Pretty soon the lukewarm is going to be gone. In the final judgment, there's no fence sitting. You're either drawn to or you're shrinking from. So for the sake of all that's holy, let's go ahead and live into the drawing near to, as opposed to being, well, you know, we'll get around to that. Draw near to God. There's four things you need to know about drawing near to God. The first one is with sincere heart. Another way to say that in your blank is undivided allegiance within. So you're not divided internally in your soul and in your spirit. Number two, with full assurance of faith. In that blank, you can put no hesitation to trust Jesus. When you're trusting Jesus, remember, he's the muscle of the Trinity. Father is the person who calls the shots. Jesus is the body of the Trinity. And the Spirit is obviously the Spirit of the Trinity. So when we're talking about Jesus, mostly we're talking about what he's done. What he has executed. And so to trust Jesus is wrapped up in there. You've trusted that he actually has finished his task, which has purchased your salvation and the reordering of creation. You have no hesitation to trust in Jesus' work. Number three, hearts are sprinkled / cleansed from guilt. In that blank, put freedom and no guilt. For the guilty in the room, I am your brother. That's my spiritual Achilles heel that the devil knows very well, although I don't invite any attack. Entertain or allow being, there are actions and people in our lives and things that occur, and I call them travel agents for guilt trips. They try to set you up on a guilt trip that will derail your walk with Christ. It's not of God. God, there are many things that come from God. Discouragement and guilt never come from God. Ever. So, there are a lot of things we accommodate. Fear, resentment, and I would say guilt. That is a sin to harbor. You're harboring a fugitive that Jesus is trying to arrange under his order and to judge and completely destroy. Do not harbor it in your home. Hand him over. Call out to Jesus. He's in here. Smoke him out. You know, let Christ have full ownership over your guilt, which he's already paid for. And you ought to be free. And if there are agents in your life that are ushering in guilt, pray in the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ is producing a lot of breakthroughs. Probably time to have a conversation. Kindly but firmly. But get behind me, Satan. I refuse to feel guilty about this. I might even be guilty. But Jesus paid for it. And he told me, if I live into this guilt, I'm actually accommodating for things that are against his order. I'm rebelling against him. Can I get an amen? All right. Number four, bodies washed with pure water. I would caution you to do not believe that this means ceremonial baptisms, because the last thing this chapter is talking about is ritualistic, ceremonial things. In Jesus' revelation, everything he says. When he's referring to pure and fresh and living water, who's he referring to? It's the Holy Spirit, Jesus' Spirit. But it's the Holy Spirit that Jesus Christ sent. And in your blank, because it says that in verse 23, what is being washed with pure water? Our bodies are. And so while you've been declared to be holy because of Christ's election and movement in your life, you still have ruts all over you. I do too. We've got blemishes and problems and habitual issues. The Holy Spirit is going to move even over your flesh to take your former Lord, which is your flesh, and make it submissive to Him and be a glorifying agent for Him. So in that blank, you can put free to obey in body. Wouldn't it be amazing if all your intentions actually happened? That's what it means to be washed in the Holy Spirit. All the things that God's put on your heart to move outwardly and become active. There's a lot of people with lots of ideas that are never done. There's lots of people with a lot of good intentions. They never write that letter. They never make that phone call. They never come talk to their pastor. They never, whatever that thing is, they don't actually do it. Intentions don't matter for squat. It's what happens, glorifying through you back to the Father. So again, the first thing that happens is that we draw near to God with a sincere heart, full assurance of faith, our hearts sprinkled and cleansed from guilt so we're free. Number four is that our bodies are washed with pure water so we can actually obey in real time. Number two, second, we are, because of the, we now have the confidence to be bound to the hope we are aligned with, which is based on Christ's accomplishments. I'm on a big Martin Luther kick right now. My wife's Lutheran, so she's been right longer than I have. The hope that we're aligned with based on Christ's accomplishments. Luther had some quote about the only things on earth that are ever any good and lasting are the product of hope. To have a child, you hear all the fear mongering. It takes a lot. I mean, there's a lot of problems going on the earth. How can you bring a child into this world? It takes faith to have a baby. Hope. It takes hope. I mean, to actively do something. You know, if you found out tomorrow by revelation that the day that Christ was returning tomorrow, and to still, because of your glory and obedience to Him, you still plant that apple tree today. You won't do things you won't do things lasting and beautiful and courageous unless it's based on the hope you have in Christ Jesus. You'll always keep your cards close to your chest. There'll always be an ulterior motive. There'll always be something keeping you back because your hope would only be based on what you can accomplish and prevent from happening negatively in your life. But if you actually trust in Jesus Christ, if you trust in His return, if you trust what He's purchased, if you trust in His perfect arrangement and lordship, if you're political like me and believe in a monarchy and not a democracy, then your hope given to you by God will cause us to do things worthwhile, to write that letter, to make that phone call, to move from intentions to actually action. And so the second thing we see, in addition to draw near from God, there's an increase in your hope, which is the tackle and fuel of actually living your life. It's hard to live your life without hope. I don't know if you've ever felt hopeless before. It is, if the world's crashing down around you, that's hopelessness. Christ has given the church hope because time's on our side. Christ is on our side. We get to go to heaven when the world's recreated. All these things are going to happen. And even until this point, even if we suffer, we don't suffer for nothing. And so all of our life is based upon confessing that what Christ has done is actual and effective, that we're flying in the plane. And from that we act. We never act out of fear, out of guilt. We don't act out of reactionaryism or being defensive. It's okay, Sherry. The only worthwhile action in your life will be based on you trusting in God, in Christ's work in your life and over the cross. That's it. If it's based on anything else, it's going to be skewed by your sin and your ego. You see? So hope has got to be the main thing that you are aligned with. That's what it means to confess. To confess means that there's a truth and you're choosing to crack your back and stay in alignment with it. So if you are aligned with who Jesus Christ is, that floods hope into your life. Number three, they use the word spur. In Greek, it's actually stir up. And the hardest translation in parentheses put irritate. Be irritating. You're a chemist. You understand you got to add catalyst to irritate whatever to happen, to have an actual reaction occur. And the things that we're trying to irritate in the fellowship are love and beautiful acts. So again, first, we draw near to God. Second, we're bound to the hope we have in Christ Jesus. Third, that we're irritating in each other, more love and more beautiful acts. Number four is we're called to share our life in Christ. With other Christians. That verse about assembling does not mean get your rears in church. It can mean that, but that's a cheap version that I think is over-preached to get people on Roundup Sunday to bring their friends to church. What that means is that you are called with confidence to align yourself in relationship with other people who are drawing near to God, other people who are hopeful in Christ, other people who are stirring up love and beautiful acts out of the gospel. Now, if you're in a blessed church, then gathering on Sunday is one of the spots. But I'm asking you as a pastor, don't make that the end-all be-all of you sharing your life with Christ. Because you can get lost in the crowd that way. That text means much more than reporting for duty on Sunday morning. Let us not give up the meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. But let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. All of these things culminate to recognize that Christ Jesus has already achieved complete victory. He's called you and purchased you to be a holy, glorifying person for His Father. And so these four acts allow these things to happen more fluidly. And they're all important. So if you're trying to run a marathon, walk this endurance race with the gospel, I've run a marathon before. I joke I did two on one day, my first and my last. But the marathon I ran was very difficult because it was a trail run with only 300 people as opposed to 10,000 people on pavement. It was up at altitude. There were times of the race I couldn't see anyone ahead of me or anyone behind me because we were on a curve. Marathons are a lot harder when you're alone. To run the perseverance of Christ in a world that's hostile to Him requires us to be in community with each other, with other people. So if you ever come across a discouraging moment, you're not discouraged by yourself. There are other people encouraging you. There's people that call you out on your BS if you're being guilty. There's people that can run next to you and really affect the way you pace as well. So if you're watching this online or this is all you do with your Christian walk, I'm encouraging you to find more and more authentic connections with other people who are right and real with Christ as opposed to just churchy things. Does that make sense? Authentic Holy Spirit relationships would be critical for our walk together. And they're enabled by the Holy Spirit. So, again, the way you walk into the bank with confidence is the way your relationships ought to roll. You can confidently walk up to a brother or sister and testify about what the Lord has done. We're going to breeze through this next section. There's only one thing I want to say about it. But if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. how much more severely do you think a man deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified him, and who has insulted the Holy Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." And again, "The Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Verses 26 through 31 on your notes. This regards the sin of apostasy. We discussed this back in chapter 6. This is someone who has been fully encountered the Lord, heard from the Holy Spirit, tasted the grace, all these, has been exposed to all these things, and spit them out. Jesus said the only unforgivable sin is blaspheme the Holy Spirit. So this is somebody who, upon final judgment, will look upon the Lord, will see everything about the Father. The Father shows him everything about him, and the guy says, or gal says, "I prefer my freedom in hell over submission to you in heaven." The other word for this is defactor. So we heard in verse or chapter 6, if you want to go back and study that lesson again, the importance of actually maturing in Christ as an assurance to yourself. If you're ever worried about this, although you can't purchase that, you can't purchase your salvation, but it's an assurance if you're maturing that you don't have to spend any time worrying about, am I a defector? In the blank, you can put defector. So this is someone, again, who's come into contact with God and said no. Now don't be afraid if you're here today and you're kind of shaky on your relationship with God. And you know, I didn't really have a bold encounter with the Lord until I was 18 that I know about. And it was very bold. And anointing and tears and breathing, and He's been tapping into that. Now I'm 34. He's been telling me what happened that I still didn't understand. And I still don't understand. He's telling me what happened at that moment. It would be like I experienced the Lord. I even had an explanation to me by a holy moment. And I tasted it. I walked in it. And I said, I don't like this. God forbid. So not everyone has one of these powerful moments that early in life, and I understand this. Although we live in a season where a lot's happening, but it's the experience of God moving dramatically in your life where you couldn't deny that it was God, and you saying, "Nope, I would rather not give up control to you. I would rather my own freedom." That's probably no one in this room, so don't worry. Does that make you feel better? Okay, good. That was the goal. I don't always care about you feeling better, but today I do. I love you. All right, verse 32 says, "Remember those earlier days after you had received the light, when you stood your ground in a great contest in the face of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You sympathized with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property, because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions." Verse 32, I've got a quote here to frame this out. It's not the strength of our faith that saves us, but the object of our faith. And below, "Some have this treasure, Christ, in a paper bag, and others in a golden chest, but their treasure is the same." Through persecution, through famine, and yet through prosperity, all the movements of the Lord in your life, it's going to reveal to yourself what your treasure actually is. And the ability of God to take somebody who has a weak faith in Him is unstoppable compared to God's movement in someone's life who has marvelous faith in something else. We are faith-based creatures, religious creatures, right, Scott? We are religious people, all of us. Secular, non, we are all religious. We try to express ourselves before something greater than ourselves. My friends that are on the far left have this ideal of tolerance or something of human progress, and so their Facebook posts are an expression of, look how tolerant I am. Let me express myself before you. You must know that it's taken root in my life, oh great, liberalism, or conservatism, or whatever the thing is. And the weakest of the brothers and sisters in Christ is royal over the strongest priest of lies. So it's not the strength of your faith. It is great. It's not the strength, it's the object. It is what's going to matter. And it's from that, when you recognize the object of your faith, lo and behold, the strength grows. Your hope is not in yourself, but in the one you look upon. Allow you to go through life, difficulties and pluses as well. Verse 35 says, so do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what He has promised. For in just a little while, He who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith. And if he shrinks back, I will not be pleased with him. But we are not those who will shrink back and are destroyed. But we are of those who believe and are saved. So verse 35, 36, you have the word confidence show up again. Same word that means the way you live your life and all other spheres that you're comfortable in. Confidence leads, here's your blank, to God's will. We are really susceptible in the immaturity of our faith to become works righteousness again. We have a taste of the Holy Spirit and or of the gospel, and we say, okay, I want to go move to Africa and be a missionary. Right? And again, as Scott and I have had a lot of conversations on this, there's a difference between deception and actual good and righteousness. And just a reminder that deception means that it looks good, and that a lot of people are deceived, and we stay immature because we do a lot for Jesus without letting Him do a lot through us. To walk in confidence in the ways we talked about, those four ways that are outlined here, in the same way you walk into the bank, that confidence is not a matter of effort. It's a matter of belonging. If you feel like you actually have a seat on the plane because of Jesus, not because you deserve it, but because you actually believe that when He died, He included your name on that because you have the gift of faith. Like, okay, I don't have to fight to get on the plane, because whether I get on today or this afternoon or this morning or whenever, no one's taking my seat. Isn't that amazing? I don't have to rush. I can be restful. I can walk and get on the plane. I belong here because Jesus says so. When you have that confidence, it leads to you joyfully doing the Lord's will. It's natural. It's a natural expression of you belonging before the presence of the Father. The last blank there, so it goes to God's will. The last blank says, richly rewarded. So confidence leads to God's will, which leads to richly rewarded. That's another topic for another day. It doesn't mean earning your salvation, although there are crowns in heaven that we get to cast. There will be a lot of diversity in heaven, and some of the biggest rock stars don't live in developed countries. They walk by faith of Abraham, the joy of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. They're never on the news. They don't own pulpits. And so your life will have a reflection on what you're doing in heaven. And so there is some sort of incentive you living boldly for Christ, but the immediate reward is that you get to see the Lord's activity in your life. For you to share testimony about what God's doing isn't you making it up or having to prove your salvation to somebody. It's God actually moved in my life, and I want people to know. This is better than a joke or a good movie I saw. I want people to know that some guy stayed at my home this weekend named Jeremy, and he attended this church, and he dreamed about this church in 2008, this facility. And he had a specific dream with Joel and all these things, and he heard from the Lord in here. When he came to town, he heard he was supposed to go to church on the rock. And the Holy Spirit moved in him and said, I have to go to this church called First Christian Church. So he got to experience. Now he's going home, and Christ, God unglued him, and he's going to put him back. But he jumped on a train moving 80 miles an hour. He didn't know what was going to happen to him. And so the rich reward you get immediately is the Lord's movement and maturing in your life. So confidence leads to God's will, leads to richly rewarded. Versus two other things. Verses 28 through 29 talks about shrinking back. Shrinks back. Next to that arrow put, draw away. Which is ironically the opposite of the first thing that should happen when you're a believer, which is draw near to God. You draw away from God, which is shrinks back. People who shrink back are destined for destruction. Again, there's no black and white. The Father shows himself, and there's either you're either massively attracted to him or repelled from him. He doesn't spend time persuading anyone. There are no classes. There are no new member classes. Is it you either hit your face and run to him, or you flee from him and say, I'd rather have my freedom and be in hell. But the faithful are called this. The last blank is trusting with faith. We draw near. And the last blank is saved. Saved. The two men died on the cross next to Jesus. Same event. One drew near, one repelled. Why? God. But there's no neutral. You love him or hate him. And those who are called to draw near to him, God has already, if you have it in you, this is called the gift of faith. If you're attracted to God, if God moves in your life and that's a good thing, you find out God's going to give you a breakthrough today for his glory, that's awesome for you. Your desire to draw near to him has already been established, victory over, and paid for so that you will be saved. No one attracted to There is not one person who's attracted to God that will be sent away. That's why God doesn't send anyone to hell. People run there. Anyone who's attracted to God, anyone who's attracted to Jesus, he fed. Who does Jesus feed? The people who are cool with Jesus. Not everyone. People say the disciple circles, all means all. Everyone gets communion, everyone goes to... What? All means all. When Jesus was here, he didn't feed everyone. Because there were people who refused to eat from him. It wasn't him. It was that they were repelled from him. He doesn't open your mouth and force feed you. God, in the end, allows it to be desire-based. You either desire your own freedom or you desire Christ. And here's a quote from Martin Luther. Again, I'm on him hard recently. As we end today, I want you to absorb this. Faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace. So sure and certain that a man would stake his life on it 1,000 times. This confidence in God's grace and knowledge of it makes men glad and bold and happy in dealing with God and with all creatures. And this is the work of the Holy Ghost in faith. Let's pray.